Well, hello everyone. I believe I'm online, so I'll go ahead and begin my talk. I want to wait a minute or so, let people join, and hope everybody's having a good afternoon. And I have about a 30-minute talk presentation for you on my book. So we'll just wait a minute or two for other people to join. Really excited about having my book come out. It's been a long time in the works. I'll get into that a little bit, but I've been working on this as a project for about 23 years. So I think maybe people have had a chance to join, and I'll just go ahead and start with my talk. I've divided my talk into four parts. I have an introduction, and then I'll talk a little bit about what turned out to be my hobby, and then I'll talk about the book. So let me begin with the introduction. And so first of all, I want to thank LSU Press, Rand Dotson, editor, Neil Novak, the copy editor, James Wilson, marketing, Sonny Rosen, publicity, who put this together. And then I had Joanne Parks help me with my index. So I'm very grateful to all those people. And before I begin and talk about the book, let me give you my thesis, because I think you should have a good understanding of where I'm going with it. So my thesis is, and I'm going to end up reading this, sorry about that. Delta Airlines has as its beginning an insidious pest that upended the social agricultural economy of the South that evolved into the airline. No single person, place, or time can be singled out as Delta's origin. To do so would discount those that came before. So having said that, let me just tell you a little bit how I got interested in this subject, and just keep that in the back of your mind. But let me start out with a little bit of my background. Dad was with Ford Motor Company, and we grew up with pictures of Ford on the wall, and talking about the company starting from very modest beginnings. And after I grew up, I went to college. I went to George Washington University, where I majored in international affairs. I was in the Air Force ROTC. And when I graduated from college, I went to flight school and flew C-130s for 5 years in the Air Force. And in 1972, I was hired by Delta Airlines and flew a variety of aircraft for 29 years. So growing up, we were exposed to quite a little bit of history of the company, and we were very much aware of Ford's humble beginnings and his tinkering with machinery. So we had this picture on the wall, and I'd like to show that to you. I still have it. But here's a picture of Henry Ford tinkering with a watch, talking to one of his neighbors. He was repairing watches. So keep that in mind as we go forward. Then one of the other things that helped inspire me with this project was I was a young in seniority flight engineer on a Douglas DC-8 jetliner, and we were cruising over the Mississippi Delta region. And it was a beautiful, clear day, blue skies, and the captain looked out the window and he pointed down. He said to us, he said, "That's Monroe, Louisiana, where Delta got its start." And I remembered that years later, and it occurred to me, I said, "Well, how did that happen?" Because when you're at 30,000 feet looking down, Monroe looked pretty small. So it looked like a very humble beginning, just like the Ford Motor Company. The next thing that happened was that in 1979, Delta was celebrating its 50th anniversary of passenger service. And to honor that occasion, the company hired two Auburn University professors, W. David Lewis and Wesley Phillips Newton, to write a book on Delta Airlines up to that point of time, 1979. And I have that book here. A copy was presented to every employee. So it's quite a substantial volume. And it was very unique in that the company gave access to the professors to go into all Delta archives, talk to all people, and pretty much write the story that they uncovered with their research. And so this was the beginning of a hobby for me. And I read the book. And then as time went on, I started thinking about the airline. And I thought, well, that was a very humble beginning, just like the Ford Motor Company. But in reading the book, it was, they situated the origins of the airline more or less in the context of the industry as a whole. They had specifics about the airline, but I thought there was more to it than that. And so, and I decided that I would start doing my own independent research to see what I could find out. And the way I approached this was that since they had already seen the information in the Delta corporate archives, I thought that I would just see what I could find out elsewhere, wherever it might be. So I sought out places that had a Delta footprint, and I would go to the libraries and archives in those places and meet people and talk to them and find out whatever I could. And so not only that, but there were books and magazine articles, and I started looking for those. The fantastic thing about it was that I was a pilot with Delta, and so I could fly to a lot of these cities on my normal route schedule. And I could go to these places on my own time on the layovers. And so it allowed me a great opportunity, a lot of flexibility, and access to a lot of these places that it would be very difficult for anybody else to do. Online, bear in mind now, we're talking about the, this would have been the mid 1990s, I guess. And bear in mind that a lot of the online sources that we have today were not available. So I would spend a lot of time in the libraries on the computers, whatever they had. Mostly it was reading machines, and just spend hours, going through those. I would get a microfiche or whatever, and just go through page by page by page. And I would do that in the US, but then I also did it in Latin America, where I was flying down to Lima, Peru. And I would leave the hotel and get into a little cab and go to the Biblioteca Nacional and with my Spanish English dictionary, and I would go to the library, and they would bring out these huge binders, and there were still the original newspapers are basically falling apart, but I could still read them, and I would go through them one by one by one by page. And I had a smattering of Spanish, but enough so I could recognize the word algodón, which is Spanish for cotton. And I discovered some material there, and also made contact with Herbert Moll, who had written a book about airmail in Peru. And so that was very helpful, and it was a lot of fun, actually. So then also during this time, I developed a relationship with Dr. Lewis, one of the authors of the book. So that was going on. And then finally, I was approaching retirement age. Age 60 is the mandatory retirement. And so I was trying to think about what I would do after age 60. And I had this hobby, and developed quite a bit of information. And talking to Dr. Lewis, I thought that I looked into the university, the PhD program at Auburn University. And it was really kind of tied right in with my interest, my subject. And of course, I had the advantage of Dr. Lewis being a professor there. So I applied to Auburn for the PhD program, or actually I retired early in 2001, and then I retired, but I retired 2 years early. And so I waited about a year, and then I got started in the program in 2002. And my research as a hobby, what I'd done, I had all that material, and that was very helpful going into the program. And one of the things you have to do when you apply for advanced degree program, PhD, you have to write a statement of purpose. And so I had this information, which I included in that statement of purpose. And that was a big part of my being admitted into the program. So then I was started in the program, and I continued to research and write papers pertinent to Delta's history. Occasionally a professor would require a term paper or something, and I would always take some aspect of Delta's history that I wanted to focus on. And I had research, but then I would do additional research, and then I would write my report on whatever that topic was. And one of them was on Mr. Woolman. Mr. Woolman is very significant in Delta's history. But as I got into researching, there's a lot of Delta lore, and his name comes up in a period where people really didn't understand what was going on. And so he gets a lot of credit for some of the things that happened, for example, with working with code for crop dusting and developing calcium arsenate. And it turns out that that was not the case. But I did my research and I wrote this paper for Dr. Lewis, and I was trying to point this out in the paper. And Dr. Lewis's comment was, Jim, he said, you know, you're telling me what he didn't do, but you really need to tell me what he did do. So I want to assure you that I took his advice. And when you read my book, you'll find out what he did do. And so we know what he didn't do, but you'll find out what he did do. So finally also I did a lot of research on Latin America and history, wrote some in my courses. I wrote some papers on the situation down there. And one of the interesting things in Latin America is that one of the aspects of Delta lore is that the impetus for taking crop dusting equipment and personnel and going south of the equator rather, to do crop dusting in Lima came from the United States. But that's not the case at all. And I get into the Latin American aspect and why the history there was so important and so instrumental in bringing Huff Daland Dusters down to Peru and then what happened there and how that all evolved. But you'll have to take a look at the book. And it gets a lot of these stories get pretty intricate, and I'm not versed enough and don't have enough time here to get into those too much. So I'm going to encourage you to read the book. So let's get into the book. Finally, the dissertation was done. It was accepted. And I earned my PhD in 2010. And at that point, I guess I slacked off. I didn't do too much. But a couple of years went by, and then I thought, well, you know, I've got this dissertation. I should see about getting it published. And at some point, I got in touch with Rand Dotson at LSU Press. And so we communicated, and, you know, basically it was my dissertation, and I think it's probably a standard response, but he said, you know, Jim, a dissertation is not a book. You know, you need a dissertation is written for basically for five people, and a book is written for a wider audience. So he gave me a couple of suggestions for books to read and suggested I revise it and then resubmit it. So I did that actually probably more than once. So it was fits and starts, and, you know, I made a little bit of progress, but still had a lot of work to do. Between then and now, or a couple of years ago, there was an opportunity to do a lot more research and do a lot more soul searching and looking up new aspects and coming up with new ideas about what actually went on and new evidence and applying the new evidence. And so that is all incorporated in the book. So the time was not wasted. It was well worth it. So then that was more research. And then I probably a couple of other revisions too. Finally, I had a friend of mine, a professor, did a very thorough edit on it. And that sat on my desk for quite a while. And something had to be done. And I wasn't really too strongly motivated. But when the pandemic hit and we were quarantined and we were stuck in the houses, remember that? Well, that turned out to be a real boon for me because I had this paper there that I had to spend time on. And I took I took a week for every chapter and did a very thorough revision. And so that time was well spent. And by the time we came out of the pandemic or quarantine, you know, it was ready to go. And I resubmitted it to, I had to write a kind of a cover letter and say, you know, I'm sorry about the length and everything, but I've done a lot of work on it. And this is what I've done. And you know, would you please take a look at it again? And he answered in the affirmative. So there we go. So it was back in the hands of LSU Press. And eventually it was accepted. They looked at it and it they went through the LSU process, and about a year ago they said, okay, we'd like to publish it, but there's still more work to be done, which I did. Let me just take a couple of seconds here. Let me go over the book and tell you a little bit about the organization. So the book is basically chronologically written, but the first two chapters, the subject kind of developed simultaneously. And so one is the boll weevil and the effects on the South and cotton and the social upheaval, and then the development of the early finding of the Delta, founding of the Delta Laboratory, where they did research. And then the second chapter brings in the airplane. So it talks about Huff Daland Dusters and I'm sorry, not Huff Daland Dusters, but Huff Daland Company that was established, first of all, in Ogdensburg, New York. And then in time, these two technologies with calcium arsenate, and then applying it to the cotton in experiments, and then that brings in the airplane. So, and the airplane and the air dust kind of combined, and then we have Huff Daland Company as the manufacturer, but Huff Daland Dusters is the dusting company. And keep those two apart, because they're separate entities, and I've tried to make that clear in the text, but I hope you won't be confused. Chapter 3 is the Huff Daland Duster Company. And it comes down from Ogdensburg, New York, and originally situates itself in Macon, Georgia. But the situation there was not particularly ideal to making money, basically. So eventually they moved, or very shortly, actually, they moved to first Tallulah, Louisiana, and then to Monroe, Louisiana. And Monroe becomes a central point for quite a bit that goes on from now on. Chapter 4 is The Eagle and the Condor. And it talks about the situation in Latin America. And Mr. Wollman follows Pedro Beltran after he came to the States, and they had an invitation basically to go down there, and very, very lucrative kind of, they were pretty much guaranteed that they would, you know, not have to pay taxes or excise taxes or anything to bring equipment in and personnel. And also they had several contracts with people that were pretty much guaranteed. So the company sent Wollman to Peru in 1926. So he goes down there, and he gets sets up all, he gets all the permissions from the government, you know, all those squared away, and then also makes arrangements for the dusting that will come, you know, subsequent to arrival of the equipment. He returns to Louisiana and Monroe in December to be home for Christmas. And then, but Harold Ross Harris, another individual who you become very close to, he's very significant. And I won't get into too much detail there, but just to say that he plays a very substantial role, and almost on it. Wollman and Harris are kind of on a par at this point. So he goes down there early in 1927, and he services all the contracts to the planters. And while he's there, there are things that are going on back in the States, and you know, airlines are starting to be developed, and people are thinking about, you know, long haul passenger lines and everything. And Juan Tripp and Richard F. Hoyt is a New York financier, and Juan Tripp, of course, is an individual interest in airlines. They get together, and they are interested in starting an airline. And so Harris, getting back to Harris, he's still down in Latin America when they're having these talks in New York. That is Tripp and Hoyt. And Harris, on his way back to the States, takes a very circuitous route, comes back to New York. And when he comes back to New York, he talks to Hoyt and Tripp. And they become very interested because now Huff Daland Dusters has a foothold there. And it's part of this umbrella group that's all funded by this New York financier, Richard F. Hoyt. And so Wolman, Harris is back in the States now, Wolman is sent back to Peru to service the contracts that Harris had signed before he left. But also he has another mandate, and that's to see if he can't get permissions to start carrying the mail and carrying passengers. So chapter six is airmail in the West Coast Project, and that gets into that. It's all down to Latin America. Don't remember that. Very interesting, a lot going on. And Wolman succeeds in getting approval for an air route and carrying the mail. He finishes up down there, and then he's on his way back to the States. And meanwhile, Harris is, they swap off each other. Harris is on his way back to Peru, but now he has new instructions because he's basically working for Juan Trip, and he's going down there to take over from Huff Daland Dusters, those mail routes and passenger routes, and they form Peruvian Airways, which very shortly becomes Panagra. So this is very interesting. We have this tie-in with Pan American and Panagra that's in South America that is a lot of people aren't really aware of. Wolman comes back to the States, and meanwhile, there were three people, Wolman and Harris and the controller, were, they wanted to buy the company out, Huff Daland Dusters, from this investor in New York. And so Harris and Wolman are away, but the third party kind of betrays them and tries to sell the company out from under them. So Wolman comes back, discovers this is going on, and there's kind of a mess. You know, eventually Huff Daland, it goes out of business, and but through cooperation with the people, business people in Monroe and Wolman, and also the head office in New York, they form a new company and sell the assets, and that's where Delta Air Service comes into play, and that's in 1928, and you have Harris as a vice president, Wolman as a vice president, and then a couple other stockholders from the Monroe community. And let's see, chapter eight is Delta Air Service. They started the passenger line, and it's called, you know, going from basically from Dallas to Jackson, Mississippi first, but then at some point it extends from Fort Worth to Atlanta. But it's a very short-lived enterprise because they began without a mail contract. And one of the mysteries is why they began without a mail contract, because you really couldn't make money without it. So it was a short-lived enterprise. It flew until 1930, when the post office awarded American Airways the contract for mail, and they could not compete with the mail carriers, so they went out of business in 1930 and basically reverted back to crop dusting until 1934. Well, then, because of the spoils contract conference mess with the government and the post office, all the mail contracts were canceled. And so they were new routes, new awards were awarded, and Delta Air Service got one of those. Oh, I should go back. When they went out of business, they reformed themselves into Delta Air Corporation. It went from basically the same management staff, but the name changed from Delta Air Service, Delta Air Corporation. And that's in the book too, and you can read all about it and understand it much better than I'm trying to explain it here. So anyway, they get the mail contract, and they start flying from Fort Worth to Charleston. So the airline is at that point is established. It's still very rudimentary in 1934, you know, very primitive airplanes. But between 1934 and 1941, where my study ends, several things happen. And there, I leave you with four indicators that are kind of set the stage and let you know that there's a future for this airline. you know, they've become established. And these aren't my ideas, but you can read about whose they are in the book. But anyway, by the time World War II began, they had moved to Atlanta and were pretty well established. But they had a viable route structure. They had a modern fleet of aircraft. They had sound management and a stable workforce. And they had access to capital. So those four factors were instrumental at the point World War II begins. And of course, World War II changes everything for the nation and the company. But by that point, they were pretty much, Delta was pretty much established as a viable airline. And so that's the conclusion is, you know, basically, I'll just reiterate my thesis. And Delta Airlines has as its beginning an insidious pest that upended the social agricultural economy of the South that evolved into the airline. No single person, place, or time can be singled out as Delta's origin. To do so would discount those that came before. But let me leave you with the caveat. I didn't make any effort in my book to determine where there might have been one place that was more significant than the other. And I kind of like them lumped them all together. So if there is somebody that wants to take the time and make it a case where, you know, maybe Monroe, Louisiana was more important than any other place, you know, you're certainly welcome to do that. But I think if you're an honest person and you make that case, you're still going to have to say that some of those people, that time, place, and people that came before had a role, and you're still going to have to acknowledge them. So when you go back to what, if you carry that all the way back, you'll get to the airplane, which was 1903, you still had to bring the boll weevil into the picture, and so it may seem a stretch to a lot of people, but to me it seems perfectly logical that the boll weevil crossed from Mexico to Texas in 1892, and that started this whole evolutionary. So it may seem a stretch, like I say, but anyway, that's the story. But it's a story of the evolution of the airline, but there's more to it as well. And it's more than a story of just the airline, because Delta's beginning, historically, it's a contribution to agriculture, the history of Southern industrialization, and of course, the development of commercial American aviation, which, by the way, includes the airline, Delta Airlines, but also aerial applications, which is such a big industry today. So before I leave you, I was asked to say that there are some links down below where you can order books, and there's a promo code. And so I will leave you at this point, and I will be glad to take some questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Yep, I'm here. Okay. So our first question is, when you're looking at your book with, in terms of the history of Delta, what is the biggest way that you think your findings in the book have maybe changed the way that you look at Delta or think about Delta, or the ways that you might think that it would change readers' perspective?
Well, I think it offers a much deeper understanding of the origins of the company. And in order to think of the company today, I think you need to really look at the origins. And so I hope that somebody would look at it with that perspective. And there are probably threads that somebody might carry forward or be able to discern, you know, with maybe from their own perspective as well. But one of the things that I discovered is that, you know, the legend and lore didn't always hold up to the facts. So the facts, I think, are the most important thing.
Thank you. Next question we have is from Stephen. Question is, Who were some of Delta's earliest pilots, and what kind of experience have they gained before they joined Delta? Were they pilots in World War I, barnstormers in the interwar period, or maybe something else?
Well, I suppose I could rattle off some names, but basically some of the pilots were all of those. You know, there were people from World War I, there were barnstormers. Lindbergh even had a shot at it, but he turned it down. He was offered a substantial amount of money, whatever they were paying, to be a crop duster, but he turned it down and went his own way. There were barnstormers, World War I aviators, and some people that just basically built their own airplanes and taught themselves how to fly. So I'd say all of those.
Thank you. Can you talk a bit more about why Atlanta became the headquarters for Delta, and why not somewhere in Louisiana, considering its start in Monroe?
The city fathers there were very air-minded. In the beginning with Huff Daland Dusters, and in the early days of Delta Air Service. But Atlanta had Atlanta is at a crossroads. And I make this point, it's a crossroad of trails and railroads. And when you think about it, it's a crossroads of airways between major cities in the South, whereas Monroe, Louisiana is not. The other thing is Atlanta had Mayor Hartsfield, and Hartsfield was a very dynamic, and I don't want to say forceful, but forward-thinking mayor. And so he was very instrumental in bringing aviation to Atlanta. And then once World War II was getting close, and the military made Atlanta a base before they did in Monroe, Selman Field. But let's see, there was one other for it. What really happened was that the company moved its management and maintenance base to Atlanta from Monroe, and that was. That was a big thing. Three big things were going on before World War II. Delta had DC-3s. They had a modern fleet of airplanes. They had already moved their base and management to Atlanta. And then they had access to financing in Atlanta with the Courts and Company, which I talk about that. And I think there's quite a bit of significance to that, because Courts and Company was one of the first companies that actually came south and was willing to invest capital in Southern industry. So that was a big factor as well.
Thank you. Can you talk a bit about reactions that you've gotten to the book? People who have read it, or maybe have connections to Delta who have read it, or even people that you know personally, you know, what sort of reactions have you gotten to the book?
Well, they've all been very positive. Of course, these are mostly people that I'm pretty close to, so I guess maybe I would expect that a little bit. But it's been vetted academically, and one of my questions for my PhD was, I said, Jim, you know, you're an airline pilot. Why didn't you just write a book on Delta Airlines? And my answer was, I said, well, if I did that, I would just be an airline pilot writing a book on Delta Airlines, but if I write a dissertation and go through the process, the PhD program, it will have, you know, academic credibility to it. It will already have been vetted significantly even before, as a dissertation, well before it became a book. So I think it adds a lot of credibility to the book, having gone through the PhD program. But people that have talked to me about it, they enjoy it. It's difficult to find somebody that maybe has the background that I do with Delta. So maybe there are specific issues that we can talk about, but overall, I think I'm the only one that has my thesis. And so it's up to me to defend that. But the readers will have their own opportunity to judge whether I've done a good job or not. And then academicians, at some point there will probably be an academic review. And I'm curious to see how those turn out. But anyway, there it is, you know, so what can I say? Just wait and see what happens.
Having said that, with your background as a pilot, how do you think that influenced your research process or your writing process?
I think it helped quite a bit. It gave me quite a perspective on operations. For example, on the first flight, you know, they left Monroe, Louisiana to Jackson, Mississippi. And this was at a time when there were no bridges across the Mississippi River south of Memphis, all the way, I don't think, to Baton Rouge. But there was a bridge that was being under constructed in Vicksburg. And this bridge was really incredible. It was a railroad road bridge. But I make the point in my text, I say that the pilot took off and was heading eastbound towards Jackson, Mississippi, and basically on a straight line course, and, you know, could use the Vicksburg Bridge, I guess, was still under construction at the time. He could use that as a waypoint. So that kind of perspective, you know, you have different vision of how people get around in an airplane. I think stuff like that might have helped.
Thank you so much. Well, that is our last question, so we can go ahead and say thank you and goodbye to the audience.
Well, thank you very much. And it's been an enjoyable discussion. And if you have comments on the book, please make a note in the review sections on any of the outlet sites. That'd be fantastic. I really appreciate it. Thank you very much.